Brother Phyllis, come up and give our prayer, please.
Okay.
Amen, amen.
Amen.
Let's give God a hand clap of praise. Glory be to God.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Hello to everyone.
Hello.
All right. Let us all bow our heads. Lord, we thank you for allowing us to have another day.
Thank you, Father.
For some of us that are older, that's quite an achievement.
Yes.
We look back, we can look back a long ways, but when we try to look forward, it's like we're looking close to the end of the line.
Yes.
And we have to, it's always before us, the clock is always before the elders. The clock is the enemy. So you have to go ahead and do what you want to do. You just have so much time allotted. Lord, we thank you for bringing these beautiful people here. Young people, middle-aged people, and old people. To hear the preacher preach this night. He's a young, strong preacher. And he has a message. He can't give a message unless God gives him one. And the way I see it, God gave him one. And we hope to support him, do a lot of preaching. Some folks said to me one time, said, are you going to do much preaching? I said, I don't know, because I might have already done it.
Amen.
I don't know. I don't know how close I am to the end of the line. Amen. Might already be done. Amen. But we're going to listen to our preacher tonight, and we're going to come out and support him, and God is going to have his rotation. The young man come in, and the old man goes out. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Let us give God a hand clap of praise. I love how Reverend Phillips delighted himself in the Lord when speaking. Tonight we're going to be very brief, but we're going to do some teaching tonight. This month is Pastors Appreciation Month across the world, across America. And God put on my spirit to all this month, we're going to talk about leadership.
All right.
Amen. Somebody say leadership.
Leadership.
We're going to talk about leadership all this month of October, dealing with Pastor Appreciation Month, and then we're going to have, in a few weeks, we're going to have a small little luncheon for our senior pastor here at Morgan Avenue. Can we give God a hand clap of praise for that tonight? For his years of service and in leadership here as the role of senior pastor. So we're going to talk about leadership, but we're going to talk about it in biblical perspective. And one thing you all have noticed about me, and me and Pastor Dan talked about this before we even decided to do this, everything I tell you all, teach to you all, preach to you all, I get it from where? The Bible. So can nobody put out no rumor or they bring up new laws, new oil, new church? No, no, everything we talk about on weekends is this way. Coming from what, Jared? The Bible. Everything in the mission comes from the way. The Bible. Everything comes from our power comes from what?
The Bible.
So we ain't bringing no new teaching. We just bringing teaching that has already what? Been written. We just need to start to do what? Obey it and go by it. Amen? So, because it's already been. So we're going to talk about leadership. And to start off tonight, I'm going to show you how to do this. And Pastor Dave, every day I'm saying, he went to Salem University, and guess what? He knows exactly what I'm doing. He knows exactly what I'm doing. Those are preachers like Reverend Phillips, I who did schooling before, I'm breaking things down. So in the book of Exodus, let's go to Exodus. It is the second book in the Bible. It is the book that is written by a leader named Moses. And there's no better place to talk about leadership if we don't talk about Moses. Mm-hmm. Amen?
That's right.
So tonight, we're going to discuss out of one verse, one chapter, all of Exodus, no, half of Exodus, and then next week, we'll deal with the last phrase of Exodus. Amen?
Amen.
Exodus means exit. In the ancient Greek word, it means ancient, going out, you know, being delivered, you know, walking out. So that's what the word Exodus means. In Hebrew and ancient Greek, you know, text is going out, exit. We're leaving out, we're walking out. Exiting things. Some things you got to exit from out of life. Amen? So I'm going to give you the scripture. And I'm going to paint the picture, and I need you all to understand the picture that I'm painting tonight, okay? Right. So let's go to Exodus chapter 14, starting at verse 4 tonight. Exodus chapter 14, starting at verse 4 tonight. Chapter 14, starting at verse 4. There's a lot of goodies in here. Reverend Phillips, you're going to like this. There's a lot of interesting stuff. Like, I've just been wrestling with God with this, and it's awesome. Exodus chapter 14, verse 4. And it reads, "And I will harden Pharaoh's heart, and he will pursue them. But I will gain glory for myself through Pharaoh and all his army, and Egyptians will know that I am the Lord." So the Israelites did this. When the king of Egypt was told that the people had fled, Pharaoh and his officials changed their minds about them and said, "What have we done? We have let the Israelites go and have lost their services."
Yeah.
So he had his chariot made ready and took his army with him. He took 600 of the best chariots along with all the other chariots of Egypt with officers over all of them. The Lord hardened the heart of Pharaoh, king of Egypt, so that he pursued the Israelites who were marching out boldly. The Egyptians, all Pharaoh's horses and chariots, horsemen and troops, pursued the Israelites and overtook them as they camped by the sea near Pihahiroth, opposite of Baal Zephon. Drop down to verse 13. Moses answered the people, "Do not be afraid, but do what? Stand still, and you will see the deliverance the Lord will bring you today. The Egyptians you see today, you will never see again. The Lord will what? Fight for who? You. You need only to do what? Be still." The Lord said to Moses, "Why are you crying out to me? Tell the Israelites to do what? Move on. Raise your staff and stretch out your hand over the sea to divide the water so that the Israelites can go through the sea on what? Dry ground." That's it. Tonight, all this month we talk about leadership. Tonight, if you want a subject or something to be in your mind to help you out, tell yourself, move on. Move on. Move on. Move on, because God, amen. Here is Moses, born in Israel, okay, in Egypt. The Israelites are in captive and been enslaved, Jerry, for now 430 some years. Amen. They in a strange land. They are in a nation that they do not know or understand, and they have learned their customs and their practices. They have a sense of God, but forgot all of God's way. Ordinance, miracles, rules, and regulations. So, after Joseph died, we're going to talk about it. We're going to stay on point, but it's too much. I'm going to just take y'all step by step. But when Joseph died, a new Pharaoh arise that did not know Joseph, did not understand Joseph. So he said to his official, Pastor David, he said, look here, the Hebrew women have too many children. And he was so ignorant, he think that Hebrew women were just popping out children. He just thought, literally, if you go back and read first chapter, he literally thought they were popping out poop. And he's gonna try to poop, he's gonna try. He thought they was actually popping out children. So he said, they are growing so fast that, watch this, that there are too many. So if they ever teamed up with our enemy, they will do what? They will defeat us. So he said, look here, let us make their labor hard. They kept on multiplying. Let's be more strict on them. They kept on multiplying. Let's do this to them. They kept on trying. Whatever Pharaoh did to the Israelites, they kept on adding just like this. Don't that remind you of us as black people in America? No matter how hard the system and things may be against us, we continue to do what Jared, add on, add on, add on, add on, and make things happen no matter what the situation or circumstances is in life. They kept on multiplying. But watch this, Brother Phil. He said, look here now, since that ain't working, let's have all the sons firstborn to be what? Killed. But allow the daughters to do what? Stay alive. How are we going to kill the firstborns? Daniel, he said this, let's put them in the Nile River. Now, if you know anything about history and all that good stuff, the Nile River was the most dangerous river to be in. You had snakes, you had alligators, you had all type of diseases, you had everything in the Nile River. You can throw somebody in the Nile River, they'd be dead like that. So here is a woman preparing to put her child inside the Nile River, put him in a basket. And while she watched her and her sister watch this particular child go through the Nile River, the basket ended up on the other side. And guess who it was? It was Pharaoh's daughter going out to bathe and heard the cry. She picked it up and said, because I drew him out of the water, his name will become what? Moses. And told the servant to go and find a Hebrew what? Woman, midwife, to nurture the child. The same woman that put the child in the river, Pastor, is the same woman they went to go get to nourish the child. Brought the child up in her home, but had to send him back to who? Pharaoh. And Pharaoh raised this child by the name of Moses. Moses grew up knowing all the Egyptian rules, revelation, the history, the mathematics, the gold, the silver. Moses grew up knowing everything he needed to know about the Egyptian way of life. He was a Hebrew, but still inside Egyptian servant Pharaoh counted him as one of his own children. One of his own son. So one day, they were beating up Moses by the guy. Moses, look, y'all brothers, what y'all doing fighting? And he said, ain't you the same man that killed the Egyptians? You want to kill the Egyptians like you killed us? Then Moses, I got to get out of here because they knew what I did. Because he saw an Egyptian beating up on one of his own, and he killed that man. So he knew that Pharaoh was going to do what? Kill him because he committed what? A crime. Moses ran. Went to Midian. seen some women at the well and became married to one of them and went to the father's house. And while he was there, he studied Midian and he studied those cultures. And one day he seen a burning bush. The bush was burning, but did not consume. The bush was burning, but did not consume. God called Moses, take off your sandals, because you are standing on what? Holy ground. Here Moses here forgot all about Egypt, forgot all about Israelite. I already had some children, Pastor Davis. He's living his best life, and here comes from God talking about take off my shoes. You are on holy ground. I need you to go to Pharaoh. I need you to tell Pharaoh to let my people go. Who am I to go to Pharaoh? He had a conversation where he started questioning God. God came on the answer every time. I get tongue tied. Oh, you got a brother. Aaron will be the one that will speak for you, and you will speak for me. Give Aaron to Aaron, and Aaron will give to what? Pharaoh. Well, how can I let them, if the children of Israel want to know, Jerry, who sent me, who I can tell them I am that I am? They said, what kind of sign? We need a sign. He said, take what's in your hand. Take your rod, and whatever I tell you to do with it is going to perform the way, the miracles and signs that you need. So let's fast forward. Moses went through all this stuff with Pharaoh to the point God's having to send how many plagues, church? How many? 10. Thank you, sister. 10 plagues. Pharaoh wouldn't give up until the last plague, when it was the death of the who? The firstborn of every child in what? Egypt, except the children of what? Israel. But at every point, ladies and gentlemen, God always hardened the heart of Pharaoh. Hold up. David, that don't make sense to me. Why would God make my enemy want to attack me? I'll get there real soon. Every time Pharaoh was making a decision, God hardened his heart. God told Moses, look, he ain't going to do what you want to do. But look, every time he gets to that point, I'm going to harden his heart more. Because God wanted Moses and the Israelites to know, and he said it in scripture, I want you to know it's going to be my hand and my hand alone that will deliver you out of what? The hands of the Egyptians. So when it came to that firstborn, they said, look, let him go. Told Moses, Aaron, come here. Take him away. Get him out of here. They left. And here come the message. Chapter 14, verse 4. I gave y'all a good lesson. And I will harden Pharaoh's heart, and he will what? Pursue them. God said, Daniel, I'm going to harden the enemy's heart to pursue you. Some of the things we go in life, Pastor, is not satanic, is not self-inflicted. Sometimes it's God-afflicted. To test you to see, will you stand still and know that who? God is God, and God all by himself.
Amen.
Amen. So he hardened his heart to pursue them. And as they were, he said, look, in verse 5, but I will gain glory for myself through Pharaoh and all his army, and the Egyptians will know that I am the Lord. So the Israelites did what Moses said. God directed Moses to do it, but the Israelites, all they had to do is just believe in who? The leader.
Y'all ain't with me tonight. If you can't trust the man of God when he directs you to do something, how can you trust God? Because he is God's representation on the way, the earth. So here goes Moses. I'm painting this picture good. Moses had to fight between two people. He had to fight the children of Israel, and he had to fight the Egyptians. Have you ever been in a situation that you had to fight not only the people you love, but had to fight the people you hate too? Y'all ain't with me tonight. Moses had to fight the Israelites because they were always crying and mourning and saying, you brought us out here just to die. You ain't no good. And then he got Egyptians on this side and Israelites on this side. So Moses in between two. So guess what? He cries out to God. He said, God, I ain't asked for this. You gave me these people. You gave me this task. You gave me this mission. I need you to step in. Well, Moses, hold up now. You're going to blame me. But what's in your hand? And y'all ain't with me tonight. See, Moses was blaming God, but God already gave Moses what he needed to do in order to deliver the children. Yeah. He said, look here. He said, look, your staff. They need a water. Take your staff. Hit the rock. Here come water. With the Pharaoh. Take the staff. It turned into a snake. The other sorcerers and magicians turned theirs into it. But Moses' staff ate up their staff. What Moses had in order to do what God wanted to do is in his hands. So if God wants you all to know tonight, the things you need to succeed in life, succeed in the church, to gain souls, is in your hand. What is it? It's in my hand. It's the word of what? God. The staff represented God's word. Whatever you use the staff to push or do, it will work. It amazes me where the feels when I read through the Bible, every miracle, everything that God used to deliver people, it was already in their hand. Y'all don't believe me? Come here. Jesus said, let's feed the folk. Well, and took Saul boy with a little lunch and said, how much what you got in your hand? He said, I got 5 loaves and what? 2 fish. Let's multiply and feed with 5,000. Y'all hear what I'm saying? You call that then. In most cases, God used a napkin and a rock to heal somebody. Whatever they needed in the power, healings and miracles, they already had it in their way. In their hands. Raise your hands and say, thank God for putting it in my hands. Thank God for putting it in my way. So while it was worthy, he had 600 chariots, the best chariots, along with all the other chariots of Egypt, with officers over all of them, had troops and all. To those that ain't had any military experience, like me and Pastor Dave's, I had a little ROTC experience. And what this scripture basically said, Pharaoh had his best of the best. He didn't have no rookies. He didn't have no privates. He had lieutenants, generals. He had folks that knew and qualified to do what? To take on the Israelites.
Yes.
Come on. Bring them all together. And here comes Moses with the Israelites. While they're running, they run into one problem and got what? Another problem behind them. Mm-hmm. Watch this. Watch that. Verse 9. The Egyptian and all Pharaoh's horses and chariots and horsemen troops pursued the Israelites and overtook them as they camped by the sea near Phihahiroth, opposite of Baal Zephon. Go on down, 13. Verse 13. Moses answered the people, do not wait, be afraid. Stand firm and you will see the deliverance the Lord will bring you today. All you got to do is do that. Stand still and watch God.
be still. Then the Lord said to Moses, why are you crying out to me? Tell the Israelites to do what? Move on. To do what? Move on. To do what? Move on. Keep moving. Raise your staff and stretch out your hand over the sea to divide the waters that the Israelites can go through the sea on what? Dry ground. So they going through a problem and got a problem behind them. But God said, why is y'all crying for? What you need to get through that problem, use the same thing you got to get out of that problem to do what? To go through this problem. Y'all ain't hear me tonight. God is basically saying, the same God that delivered you the last time will do what? Deliver you this time. Take what's in your hand, Moses, and tell the sea to do what? Divide itself.
That's right.
Why are you crying? When I gave you the instructions to help the church and to help this people. As a believer, you got to learn how to use what you got.
That's right.
Y'all ain't hear me tonight. As a believer, you got to learn how to do what? Use what you got. I'm 28 years old, been preaching ever since I was 7 years old. And people said, I'll never make it. I'll never succeed. I'll never go through this. But you know what? If I would listen to people, I would have been dead a long time ago. But I had to do what? Keep on moving on. You'll be amazed how many times Pastor Davis wanted to give up and throw in a towel on his church and say, look here, I'm going to kick rocks and keep on going. But because the Lord told him to keep on believing, keep on trusting, I'm going to make a way for you out of no way. This new church should have never been built.
That's right.
If he would have listened to me, the naysayers. Ooh, y'all ain't with me tonight. 10 more minutes, I'm out here. If he would have listened to the naysayers, we would never be where we are today.
That's right.
Can I get an amen?
Amen.
And even though God placed us over here, we still got what? Enemies to fight what? Over here. But God had to deliver us from over there to over here just to show us that, look here, I'm God.
Yeah.
And I'm all by myself.
Yeah.
And if memory serves me correct, Jeremy, when we was over there, we didn't have that much. We didn't have that much, but we had enough to get us to what? Over here.
Yeah.
That's what Moses was basically saying. Look here, God, to the Lord, use what you got.
Yeah.
So picture in your mind the sea, the Red Sea. It's split. Water on the left side. Water on the right side. And guess what, Kayvon? They walking through the sea on dry ground. Ain't getting muddy. Nothing biting them. Nothing harming them. But they on way. Dry ground. And this is how amazing God is. When the enemy see what God is doing for you, the enemy love trying to find a way to still get you. Oh, here you go. This last part. Watch this. Watch. It says, once he told him that in verse 16, he said, verse 17, here go God again. I will harden the hearts of the Egyptians so they will go in out of them. I will harden the hearts of the Egyptians, do what the other day, to go in out of them. Some of the enemies that are going after you, God already sent them at you. But you got to do what? Once again, be still in the way that God will what? Deliver you. So you harden the hearts. And they got out to them. They go, they're on the chair. So watch this, Jacob. I'm running from some enemies that driving chariots and horses, and I got on church. Because none of them had any type of life. They was walking on what? Foot. So watch this. They were going after them. Look at this. They were going after them. Verse 18. Watch this. And I will gain glory through Pharaoh and all his army. Verse 18, the Egyptians will know that I am Lord when I gain glory through Pharaoh, his chariots and horsemen. Verse 19, watch this. This is something to me. Then the angel of God, who had been traveling in front of Israel's army, withdrew and went well. And went where? Are y'all with me?
Yeah.
Verse 19, what does it say? The angel of God who had been traveling in front of Israel's army withdrew and went where? Behind them. The pillar of cloud also moved from in front and stood where? Behind them. Coming between, look at this right here, Philip. Coming between the armies of them, of Egypt and Israel. Throughout the night, look at this, picture this in your mind. Throughout the night, the cloud brought darkness to the one side and light to the what? The other side. So neither went near the other all night long. Ain't God good, Jeremy?
All
Pastor Davis, while they were behind them, God had a plan the whole time. He kept the leader in front. And he put the leader in front and told the angels to do what? Get behind them. So guess what? It's an angel in between what? The enemy and what? Israel. So while the enemy is trying to kill Israel, there's an angel confusing the enemy. They got on the other side. When they got on the other side, the Bible said God told Moses, take the same staff. And what he told him to do, verse 26, he said, stretch out your hand over the sea so that the waters may wet, flow back over the Egyptians and their chariots and their horses. Moses stretched out his hand over the sea, and at daybreak, the sea went back to its place. The Egyptians were fleeing toward it, and the Lord swept them into the sea. The water flowed back and covered the chariots and horsemen. The entire army of Pharaoh that had followed the Israelites into the sea, not one of them survived.
All right. Drown.
Move on.
Mm-hmm.
Move on.
Keep it moving.
Move on. Uh-huh. Keep it moving. Yeah. Whatever God tells you to do, mm-hmm. just move on.
Amen.
You're going to have haters. You're going to have people that talk about you. Yeah. You're going to have people that say this and say that. Yeah. But a real leader does what? Keep it on moving. Right. Use what you got. God had already put it in your hand. If Moses would have just used his staff like God commanded him to do, it was the staff that got them out of Egypt. It was the staff that got them through the Red Sea. It was the staff that got them through the wilderness. It was the staff that got them through heartache and pain. All you got to do is do what God gave you. Making me the liar and the dream. Go smash.
with some hard-headed folk. And you know what? God also whooped Moses
for
listening to the people. And we're going to talk about that next week, but Moses, that's why they always like the Moses. That's why the Pharisees and them, Bible taught them, we went Moses' law. Yeah. We went the Mosaic law.
Yeah.
Moses was the foundation
that's right.
of the word of God, the principles of being a good leader. Yeah, you're going to have some falls. You're going to mess up. You're going to go through stuff. But if you do what God stand still and know that what I am God.
That's
right. See, this our power. Jerry, it's going to keep on growing.
Yeah.
Some nights we're going to have five. Some nights we're going to have two.
Yeah.
Some nights we may have three. But you got to keep it with moving.
Yeah, right.
You got to keep it moving and know that God is going to do what the ad and take it away. This is what we need this month. It's leaders that are going to be bold about the vision of God. Pastor Davis needs on the same thing.
Oh,
And the doors of the church now open. I have to get my chains right now. Let us hear God and hands out the prayer. Amen. Let's bring up two of them. Amen. Amen. Reverend Phillips, when we decide we're going to do also, just like you said, we're going to start using tonight's off, you know, for the benefit of our ministry.
Okay.
So when we go back there, we ain't got to do that again. Amen?
All right.
That's fine with you, so.
Yes, sir.
You give to, when you give to the get a Jerry, we're going to go on ahead and do that.
All right.
Amen. Let's, we're going to have our secretary at Will's night. We're going to have Pastor Davis come up here for these two young men, Pastor. Yes, we open the doors of the church.
Amen.
Amen. It's on you.
All right. Okay.
Y'all know.
Those that are taking over about that, this next bill comes in baptism.
Amen.
And so we'll let it come. Listen. We have here. State your honor.
Father.
Father.